He's 3 and 4 now. You 3 and 4.
Because I have playing Peaches and Mighty Michigan.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. When you have it, say I have it. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright and one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Now can you go to the 2nd chapter? I will be reading from verse 6. So the Lord said to Satan, behold, he is in your hand, but spare his life. Chapter 6, verse 10. Then I will still have comfort. Through in anguish I will exalt. Let him not spare, for I have concealed the words of the Holy One.
Yes.
Can you turn to the last chapter, 42, verse 12?
Watch out now.
Now the Lord bless the later days of Job more than his beginning, for he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 female donkeys.
Okay. Work it.
The devil stole so many things from Job, and in the last verse, God gave it back to him. Because it was saying in the last verse, the Lord blessed the later days of Job.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the Lord. Yeah.
Also, Job was blameless and upright and one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. So the Lord said to Satan, behold, he is in your hands, but spare his life. So the Lord spit. First the devil stole everything from Job, and then God gave it back to him, and then that spared his life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
Then I will still have comfort up through anguish. I will assault him, but let him not spare. The Lord blessed the later days of Job more than his beginning. So God gave everything back to Job. Don't worry because if the Lord, the devil stole so many things to you, don't worry because God's going to give it back to you. Keep your trust in God. So God is a loving and caring God. Don't keep your trust in him because he won't give up on you. So don't give up on him. Pray my joy and my strength in him.
I know when you're preparing and you do a real good study, you get a lot of information. And you really have to figure out how you're going to put our very first speaker will be coming talking to us about victory. Oh, let me tell you this. Our theme is the 12 days of Christmas. And we use it from the lyrics of Keith Wonderboard Jackson. I got it right. See, Minister Elvin Joseph was messing with me last week when I was trying to announce this. So I said, I know it was Keith Wonder. And I looked at him, he said, Bread. Wonder Bread. He was just messing with me, y'all. It's Wonderboard Jackson's lyrics. So our first speaker will be talking about victory and shouting shoes. Let's pray with her and for her as our own MIT Lenore Ferrer is coming to let God use her at this time. Come on.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I'm so excited for the opportunity to come before you to give a word that God has given me concerning our theme today. And the Lord gave me three words to instruct me when I come and speak tonight. He said, Lenore, thank the people, pray first lady in their absence for giving me the opportunity to, and for seeing the call of God that is on my life. And I'm just going to go right into my prayer, and then I'm going to go right into the word, because Elder Mason means, when she say 10 minutes, she means 10 minutes. All right? All right, let's pray. Father, we just thank you, Lord. We give you praise and we give you honor. Father, absolutely none of me, but all of you, Lord. Father, absolutely none of me, but all of you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me, Lord God, to bring a word to your people. And God, let them hear the message and don't worry about the messenger, God. Oh, God, that is all for your goodness, all for your kingdom, and all for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. The scripture that I was assigned to tonight, it is from Psalms 118 and 15. And I'm going to read several versions of different translations very quickly because it's going to bless you. And it reads as the following. The voice of rejoicing and salvation is in the tabernacle of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does powerfully, or you can say does gloriously. And the International Version reads as shouts and joy and victory resound in the tent of the righteous. And the Lord's hand has done mighty things. And the Aramaic Bible in plain English, it reads, the voice of praise and salvation is in the tent of the righteous. And the right hand of the Lord Jehovah has performed miracles. And last, the next Bible reads, they celebrate deliverance in the tents of the godly, and the Lord's right hand, it conquers. See, this is a song they say that was the last song that before Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane. And he sung this song, and he had this in his spirit. And reading about David, if you know anything about King David in the Bible, David had to come against many things. And David understood what it is like rejoicing and in salvation. Because King David knew better than anyone about the right hand of God exalted on his behalf. See, when the right hand of God is exalted on your behalf, the right hand of God, it represents protection and power and might and dominion. And it is full of ability and authority. And David, I tell you thee. For his right hand is exalted. And exalted also, it means it is lifted up, it is raised above every trial, every tribulation, every circumstance that you're going to come across. Oh God. See, what I love about David is David knew God. David just didn't know of God, but David knew God. David had a personal, intimate relationship with God. That David knew that even when he was entering into the city, that David could praise the Lord, and he could enter into the tent rejoicing because the right hand of God had allowed David to beat all his enemies. And I didn't say some of his enemies. He defeated all his enemies. Oh, somebody ought to give God a praise.
Of Christ. Yes. Yes.
Ooh, thank you, Jesus. And I say today, by, that we know that we have the assurance to enter in rejoicing. We have the assurance to know that with God's right hand extended on our behalf, that we can defeat anything that comes against us. We can defeat anything that comes against our families. And God, just like, tell the people, even the people when you go to work and you're experiencing hardship on your job, God said tomorrow you go in knowing the right hand of God is extended on your behalf. And when the enemy is waiting and lurking for you, you know that you are to move in the right hand of God's strength, in his power, in his might, in his ability, that you have the right to tell that devil or tell that enemy that he is under your feet. Amen. Our next speaker will be coming talking about praying preachers, mighty missionaries. And that's none other than MIT, Derek Williams. Let's say amen for him as he comes. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. Trying to get over a cold, so please bear with me. That's not going to stop what I'm about to say. I'm coming out of Ephesians 4:11. And when the scripture was given to me, at first I was kind of shocked that I was chosen selected. And it kind of fit where I personally felt based upon what the scripture was saying. And in the scripture, verse 4:11 out of Ephesians, it reads, "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers." I'll say it again. "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers." For the time that is allotted to me, I want to talk tonight about the difference between gifts and presence. Gifts and presence. When we look at the scripture, when we look at this, the book of Ephesians, we understand that Paul was addressing the church of Ephesus, and when we realize that he's talking about the fivefold ministry, you know, a question arose within myself: why did God choose five people instead of choosing six or seven? First of all, when we look at the number five, we understand that five is symbolic to God's goodness and favor. A lot of times we have placed ourselves in situations that it was only by his goodness and favor that God assigned. Secondly, God's grace is symbolic to the number five. But when we talk about gifts and presents, it is something that it kind of rattled my mind, because we're in the holiday season now, and a lot of times you go to someone's house around Christmas and people say, "Bring your gifts, bring your presents." But a lot of times the presents are things that's up under the tree, things that we want to see. But a lot of times the gifts are things that are hidden.
Yes.
Not only are they hidden, but a gift, 95% of the time, is not going to be wrapped up. And it brings me to something that happened last week when I got this text. We were out having dinner with my brother Xavier and Lady Chanel, and a gift was given to her. When the gift was presented to her, the gift was a Louis Vuitton bag. But what was in the bag wasn't Louis Vuitton. So it kind of rattled my mind, but it made perfect sense. Not throwing shade, it made perfect sense. A lot of times, we see things that look a certain way on the outside, but what's on the inside doesn't match what's on the outside. But in the retrospect of that, a lot of things that's on the inside of us, people overlook because of what's on the outside. So my question is, how many of us are coming here, coming into the house of God, that are gifted, but we're present? Present. If I go into a room and the teacher calls my name, the lawyer calls my name, the doctor calls my name, and I'm in a room amongst other people, I'm going to say present. I'm not going to say I'm here, I'm saying present.
All right.
But when you look at the word present, present is something that is presented to someone to make them remember an event. The problem with that, when you come to the house of God and you are gifted, but you are present, you're only allowing people to see something that they remember for a certain amount of time. But if you're gifted, not only are you gifted, it will change dynamics that they will remember and they will follow them for a long period of time. If I give anyone in here a present, I guarantee you by Monday you'll forget about it. But I do believe if I give you a gift, this time next year you will remember the gift. Is it because what's on the inside of the gift, or is it what the significance of the gift is? God chose apostles, teachers, preachers, all of those individuals, but they are the pillar of the church. The issue is we have too many people that are not operating their gift because they want to do someone else's gift. But when you do that, you're now being present. If God has called you to be a missionary, be a missionary. But if he has not told you that you are a pastor, an apostle, an evangelist, then how can you place that title on yourself when you do that? You're now coming to God's house saying, I'm present. But nevertheless, even going a step further, a lot of times we miss the mark, not because of what we've done Monday through Saturday, Saturday through Sunday. The issue is when we come to God's house, we want to come into God's house trying to present God a present when he's given us a gift. You can't do that. If God has given you a gift, reciprocate what he's given you. So if I come into the house of God and I know that I'm not a singer, I am not going to present myself present to be a singer, because I am not gifted to be a singer. I am only present. So we have to understand praying preachers, mighty missionaries. Praying preachers. A preacher that does not pray is not a preacher. A preacher that does not pray is a motivational speaker. Because you have to pray in order to move mountains. You have to pray in order to see the sick. You have to pray in order to see blind eyes open. But you cannot see those things happen if you come to God's house in your presence. But that's, you know, mighty missionaries. Mighty is something that is strong, something that is impressive, something that is remarkable, something that is astounding. But the issue is, missionaries is not an individual that people see on Sunday. They see preachers. The problem with that is, if God has said in Matthew, go ye therefore in all the earth, he's actually giving you a platform bigger than this. China, Japan, Australia, Turks and Caicos, Barbados. The issue and the problem that I have really discovered just sitting back and watching is people are taking off hats that don't fit their heads, and they're putting on hats that are too small. God cannot call you to say things you don't fit them, period. If he calls you to a mighty missionary, be mighty in the gift that he has given you so that you're not present in him. No, not only that, or not only are you present when you come into his house, you're not utilizing the gift that he's given you. If God called me to be a preacher, then I have to operate in that, but I also have to pray. Faith without works is dead. But also, it takes prayer to have faith. If you don't pray, how can you have faith? If I don't pray when I don't see the money in the bank, then how can I have the faith to believe the bill be paid? If I'm a mighty missionary and I'm supposed to be strong and mighty in battle, how can I go into the battlefield as a missionary and I'm not mighty and strong? I'm not prayed up. Because the enemy, in 1 Peter 5, it says, the enemy is wise and cunning, seeking whom he may devour. But it also says he's running rampant as a ravaging lion. Yeah. If I am considered to be mighty, I don't care how big the lion is, he to me is a domestic cat. But we have to understand and realize that God has called us to do certain things. We have to do those certain things according to what he has called us. Because at the end of the day, he chose us. We didn't choose ourselves. We didn't choose ourselves. And it doesn't matter what you have been called to do. Do your job. Be prayerful. Be mighty. Walk in excellence. And do it to the extent, the excellence of God. And when you do that, not only will you come to church present, you come to church present and gift.
Is coming to talk to us about song to sing, musicians, and none other than Minister Fenitra is coming. Come on. Amen. Let's say amen for her as she comes.
Praise the Lord, everybody. And First Lady and First Family. And I would just like to give honor to my family that's here today. My mother is here, praise God. us pray. Father God, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus that your power and your Holy Spirit will take over right now in the name of Jesus. Our decrease in you will increase on every level in this house, oh God. Hide me behind the cross, oh God, so that I can go forth and do your will, oh God. Well, Father God, I ask that you allow me to be an extension to my pastor and first lady, oh God. Oh, Father God, build me up, oh God, on your foundation. And I thank you, Jesus, that everybody that has breath will praise thee, the Lord, in this house today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay.
God is calling you to another level of praise in this season. If I had to give this message a title, it would be Don't Discount the Value of Your Praise. In this text of Psalms, in Psalms 150, God is providing instruction as to where, why, and how, and who should praise him. I believe in this season, God is calling all the worshipers to praise him with a radical praise. In Acts 16, God illustrated how Paul and Saul were put in prison. But at midnight, Paul and Saul were praying and singing hymns to God. And the prisoners were listening to him. Suddenly there was a great earthquake. So the foundation of the prison was shaking. And immediately all the doors were opened and all the chains were loosed. I believe God is asking, where are all the radical praisers like Saul and Paul in this season? Just as God released the chains on Paul, he will do the same for you. Paul and Saul knew the secret of how to raise their spirits above their situation. They entered into God's presence and power. Through Saul and Paul's praise and worship, their hearts were elevated to activate God's presence. As I was doing this text, I heard the Spirit of the Lord saying, believers have allowed sin to dilute the world, creating chaos instead of order, death instead of life, and substituting adultery for worship than worshiping the one and true only God. God is saying we have diluted praise and worship by allowing social media, entertainment, and idols to identify who we are. We have allowed them to let us know how we should worship God and where we should worship God and who we should worship.
My Lord.
I believe Saul and Paul entered into the gates of Thanksgiving. And they had a praise on their lips from Psalms 150. I believe that they made their prison the sanctuary. And that Saul and Paul made the prison their sanctuary. They put a praise on their lips from Psalms 150. They said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord in the sanctuary. Praise him for his mighty firmament. Praise him for you in Psalm 150 as to where and why and how and who you should praise. And when you have learned the value of praise, you will then have learned how to pray your way through all situations. Don't discount your value of praise. To the glory of God, I give God the glory today. Thank you.
Jaden Smith and Zion Smith. Let's say amen for them as they come.
Amen.
Amen.
Let your power fall when your name is called. Prove the doubters wrong. God, you're still mighty and strong. So fight this battle for me and help my unbelief so I can tell all my friends that you have won again. Let your power fall when your name is called. So I can tell all my friends. Oh, I wish I had a witness in my life. Let your power fall.
So glad that she brought them out tonight. Amen. Moving on to our next speaker. And our next speaker will be talking about praying and angels watching. None other than our MIT Sydney Walker. Let's say amen. Amen.
First, I'm giving honor to God who has said that in my life.
Amen.
First, I want to thank each and every one of you who came out to support us as a ministry. I'm telling you, I am nervous and this is not easy. But I'm going to let God have his way. I would like to make reference to my pastor, Pastor Frank Jacobs and Lady Kim Jacobs in diocese. As well as I want to thank those of you who came over an hour away just to support me from my home church. So I thank you ladies as well. All right, so I'm going to get straight into the word. So the scripture that I'm going to be coming from is Matthew 26 and 41. It says, watch and pray. Lest you enter into temptation. For the spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. So in this particular scripture, and I'm going right into the word. So in this particular scripture, God had went to gather three disciples. He gathered Peter, James, and John. So whenever he gathered John, Peter, and James, I'm nervous, y'all, so y'all have to pray. So whenever he gathered the three disciples, he took them up into the mountain of Gethsemane, and he asked them to pray with him. He asked the three disciples to come over here and begin to pray while he wasn't feeling right in his spirit. And whenever he wasn't feeling right in his spirit, while telling them to go over here and pray, he stepped off to the side and prayed. But before he stepped to the side and asked them to pray, he said, "Do not fall into temptation, for temptation is not the best option for us." So then at that point in time, while when he stepped away to go into his praying himself, he asked God, he asked those three to, of course, not pray. So, y'all pray for me, y'all, because I am so nervous.
Thank you. We got that.
This is one of my phobias of speaking in front of people, so. All right, so whenever he had took the three up into Gethsemane to pray, he asked him, three disciples to step over to the side and kneel down and pray with him and watch and see what's going on. And when he asked him to go out and watch and see what was going on and pray, he stepped to the side saying, "Hey, I'm gonna step over here and pray." Many times we ask different people to pray for us, but not only can we ask them to pray for us, if we don't pray for ourselves, God is not gonna move. We can't just step out in the midst of and ask somebody to pray for me and we don't put in work for ourselves. So what God took them, what God asked them to do is go out over here and pray while I'm over here praying. And the three disciples, while they were supposed to be praying, ended up falling asleep. So whenever the three disciples fell asleep and God, you know, came over and asked them, "Hey, you were not supposed to yield into temptation." So whenever the three disciples yield into temptation, he said, "Hey, you guys got to wake up. We're only supposed to be here for 1 hour. And this 1 hour, we're supposed to be praying and fasting and pretty much seeking God for his face, because the feeling that I'm feeling is not correct." So he had asked the three, "Hey, God, you got to stay awake and stay over here and pray." So whenever God asked the three to pray, he left the three disciples to go back and to finish praying. And once God went back and finished praying, he then asked the disciples, he went back to check on the disciples, and a second time, the three disciples had fell asleep. And once those three disciples had fell asleep again, once again, those three disciples had fell into temptation. Many times in life, we come across many things, such as there is food that gives us temptation. There are different men and women that gives us temptation. There are different things that we want to do. Sometimes lying is a temptation. Sometimes stealing is a temptation. We have to realize from God that everything that is temptation is not correct. So many times we have to go out and seek God, seek God's face, and ask him to guide us through everything that needs to be guided. So these particular three disciples went out and again, they fell asleep for a second time, and God, you know, went over and said, "Hey guys, you guys got to stay awake. Hey, I need you guys to stay awake and pray with me while I'm seeking God's face." So whenever God went out and got it, so again, he walked off from them to pray for a third time. And the third time, while he was over there praying, he went and checked back on those three disciples. And those three disciples, again, had fell asleep. So at this point in time, I come to tell you all today that whenever you have a temptation, no matter what your temptation is, you have to understand that whether your temptation is alcohol, whether it's marijuana, whether it's any kind of drug, you have to understand that if you don't fight that temptation, then the temptation makes you weak. So in this particular situation, these three disciples had pretty much lost against temptation. For those of you who don't know what temptation is pretty much doing something that is wrong. Temptation is doing something that is not right. So in this particular event, the three disciples had did something that was not right, and it caused Jesus issues, it caused him problems. Jesus was supposed to be gone, he was supposed to go and be crucified in just a few days. So in this particular situation, we have to understand that whenever we're out there and we're supposed to be fighting temptation, though temptation comes, we have to be stronger. In this particular situation, if those particular three disciples would have been out praying and doing what they were supposed to do, these things would not have happened. I believe that it would have been a different story. It would have been a different scenario. It would have been a different situation. So in this particular situation, we as people have to learn that whenever we get these temptations, that if we believe and pray and ask God, God gives us the gift of praying. He gives us the gift of knowing what's going on. He gives us the gift of praying and talking to Him. But we have to have the faith, and the faith to believe that all things are possible, no matter what's going on. And once we believe that all things are possible and what's going on, He'll send His angels to watch over us. And once He sends His angels to watch over us, any temptation, any trial, anything that we're going through, we can overcome that obstacle. We can overcome that temptation, no matter what it is, no matter who it is, no matter what is going on. So in this particular situation, I believe that for angel watching and the gift of praying, if long as we pray and seek God's face and do what we're supposed to do, and we have faith to bring the two together, God will send us an angel from heaven to watch over us. Amen.
Harmonizing and wise deacons, none other than MIT Rhonda Holmes. Let's amen for her as she comes. Amen. Praise the Lord, saints. I've been blessed by my sisters and brothers in Christ. Amen. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time with accolades, but I do want to honor my pastor and first lady in their absence and thank them for this opportunity. I'm going to get right into what God gave me. We're talking about deacons' voices harmonizing and on one accord. And the two words we're going to clue in on is harmonizing and one accord. Our scripture, the subtopic that God gave me, He says to get off the cord and get on one accord. That's what God gave me for the people. In Romans 15 and 6, it says, so that with one accord, you may with one voice glorify and praise and honor the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, harmonize. What harmonize means? It means to coordinate, go together, match, blend, produce a pleasing visual combination. One accord, what does that mean? With one mind, one passion, and in unison. You may ask, what does it mean to be on accord? I'm glad you asked. It means you are slowing down and hindering progress with your contrary ways and attitudes. And I'm gonna give you an example. If someone is rolling up a cord, you know how you have an extension cord and you're rolling it up? If I come and I step on that cord, they can't go any further without a struggle until you get off the cord, and then they can continue rolling it. If you have a water hose that's pouring out water and someone come and step on that hose, the water either comes to a halt or it has a slow drip. But once you get off of it, it goes full blast. What God is saying, we've seen slow drips of His anointing, but if we ever decide to all be on one accord, we will experience a full blast of His presence. One accord. We're talking about one accord. And I had to go back to verse 5 in Romans 15 in order to bring this together, because the mere fact in verse 5 that Paul put these words in the form of a prayer, it says that he recognized that having one mind and being on one accord is a work that the Holy Spirit must do in us. We don't automatically want to come together and do things in unison and be on one accord. The Holy Spirit has to do the work in us. Unity is the key and important to God. He says in Psalm 133:1, behold how good and pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. One of the greatest days in church history was on the day of Pentecost. God was going to perform great miracles and show his mighty power on this day. But it was important that they were on one accord to set the atmosphere. That was important in order for God to come and do the mighty work. And we know that in Acts 2:1, on the day of Pentecost, when it was fully come, they were all on one accord in one place, and suddenly came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. We have to be on one accord, saints. According to scripture, great things happen when we are in harmony and on one accord. In Acts 1:14, they were on one accord in prayer. In Acts 2:46, they were all on one accord in the temple. In Acts 4:24, people saw many signs and wonders because they were on one accord. The evidence of being on the cord, I'm gonna give you a few pointers, the evidence that you are on the cord. If every time a directive is given by leadership, you murmur or speak against it, you on the cord. Philippians 2:14, do all things without murmuring and disputing. If you say, I can't work with this one, or I can't work with that one, you on the cord. God says in 2 Corinthians 6:1, we are workers together with him. So if God says we're workers together with him, who are we to say we can't work with someone? If you are sitting on your gift and not offering your services for the building of the kingdom, you're on the cord. John 9:4 says we must work while it's day. The night comes when no man can work. If you are part of a clique that excludes others, you are on the cord. God says in Romans 2:11, for there is no respect of person with God. So who are we to exclude people out of our group? So now I'm going to give some evidence of you being on one accord. You have a heart and passion to help bring the vision to pass God has given to our pastor. Jeremiah 3:15 say, I will give you pastors according to my heart. Number two, you are available and willing to work wherever there's a need. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Number three, you are welcoming new people with open arms into the vineyard and helping them to get to their rightful place in ministry. Romans 15:7 says, continue to welcome and accept one another just as Christ has accepted and welcomed us. Who are we to say we don't want somebody in our ministry? Who are we? How can we get in harmony and on one accord? First things first, repent of your divisive ways. Die to yourself and realize it's not about you. There's a bigger purpose and plan that God includes that includes much more than just you. Get out of your flesh and see things and people through the eyes of God, realizing that unity brings him glory. So if you're causing division, you're bringing glory to the devil. It doesn't bring glory to God. God is about unity, harmonizing, one accord. And in closing, the next time someone comes to you speaking contrary to leadership, to the vision of this house, to God's word, or his purpose, I want you to say, excuse me, you're on the cord. Get off the cord and on one accord. God bless you. Workers.
Xavier Wiggins. Let's say amen and speak up.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. How many people have to be in the house of God one more time? Amen. Amen. Let me just give this disclaimer. I'm not up here trying to sound all deep and wonderful. The devil tried it with a cold this week, but God blocked it with my praise. Amen. First, I want to give honor to the spirit of Christ who's head of my life, to my pastor and first lady. I know that they're not physically here, but I feel their presence here with us. Amen. Amen to everyone that's here and took time out of your busy schedules. And to my brothers and sisters in Christ, I really enjoyed everything that has been said.
Amen.
Amen. All right, so I'll be coming from Matthew chapter 9. And I'm going to begin at the 36th verse. And it reads, I'm going to start in the King James Version and then read in the Message Version. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then saith unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into the harvest. And then in the Message Bible it reads, then Jesus made a circuit of all towns and villages. He taught in their meeting places, reported kingdom news, and healed their diseased bodies, healed their bruised and hurt lives. Then he looked out over the crowd with his heart broken. So confused and aimless, they were like sheep with no shepherd. What a huge harvest, he said unto his disciples. How few workers on knees in prayer for harvest hands. Oftentimes in Christendom, we always find that it is the hardest in the church to gather a group of volunteers to come together, whether it's for an event, whether it's for evangelism, amen, or whether it's simply fellowshipping one to another. But as soon as the leaders say that they're going to be passing out presents, money, or food, the list becomes endless. Now, the dictionary defines a servant as one employed to perform domestic or other services. Someone who is hired can, if he so chooses, leave his job for various reasons at any time. If he's not happy with his employer or working conditions or even the money that he's getting paid, he can quit and find something a little bit more suitable. Slaves, however, do not have that option. The dictionary defines a slave as a person who is owned by and forced to work for someone else, or a person completely controlled by specific influence or emotion. Although Jesus is shown calling his disciples servants, in many translations, it's actually meaning slave. As we have just been shown, there's a difference between a servant and a slave. So my topic tonight is, I'm a slave for you. The apostle tells us that we were bought with a price. That's in 1 Corinthians 6 and 20. For as much as you know that you are not redeemed by corruptible things, as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, who is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's true that Christians, we were purchased by the blood of Christ. If you don't know, you all know the story about how Jesus went up to Calvary and he was piercing his sides, he had the nails in his hands, and the blood that ran out of his body, that was the blood that actually purchased our lives. So, you know, oftentimes we come to church grudgingly, or we say, well, you know what, I'm just going to go to church because the Lord just wants me to show up there. He don't want us to just show up there. He wants us to develop a slave mentality for him. He wants us to be so dedicated to him that whenever the doors of the church is open, we run here asking, what must I do to be saved? How can I help build the kingdom of God? You know, and it's a shame how often in church, you know, you see so many beautiful churches on the outside, and then you go in, you see so few people, or you see everyone just sitting on the pews because they either sick or they feel, you know, they look downtrodden. And you know, that's because we lack slaves in the church. Now, some of you guys might say, I'm not going to slavery, or I'm not trying to be no slave. But how many of you guys know that when you become a slave for God, things in your life begin to shake up? When you become a slave to God and you just begin to pray, because you know, the money may not be there, but your prayers can produce that money, huh? And then your prayers can produce somebody to walk up to you randomly to just bless you and meet that need. So many of us feel that we have to be the master. We're gonna tell God, I want you to do this. I need my rent, so you're gonna give my mama the money so that she can give me the money so that I don't gotta pay her back. But you know, often, that's not the way that God works. A lot of times, and I know from experience, he'll wait till that last minute. You know that rent is due at 5 p.m. You sitting there scratching your head, looking at your watch. Lord, what are you gonna do? You promised that you were gonna do it. And it's not because he didn't do it because he can't do it. He didn't do it at that moment because you're looking in the wrong place. You don't have that slave mentality. I know years ago when there was slavery happening in this world, you know, and the slaves would be beat and persecuted for different things. They did what the master said, even when they didn't like it. God called us to pray. We may not always want to pray, but it's a mandate that we must pray. A lot of us lack different things in our lives because we don't have a prayer life. Too many of us are deaf in the spirit. We're here, we can hear what the pastor is saying, but we don't know nothing that God is saying. God can be saying, go over there, there's some money under the rock, but you don't know his voice. So I said, it's true that Christians, we were purchased with the blood. And we thank God for the blood, because in that blood you can find everything there. You can find your healing there. I found my healing in the blood. Yeah. You know, you can find your money for school there. You can find debt relief in the blood. But people don't know how to press towards the things that we're supposed to press towards. We rather sit around and have pity parties. We want to praise the devil. And when I say we want to praise the devil, we say, well, you know what? I ain't got it, so I guess I'm not going to give it. You're giving the devil too much credit. You know, and oftentimes God placed things on our lives so that we can be a testimony to someone else. But again, we want to give the devil credit. Well, you know, the devil made me sick. Have you ever thought that a lot of times when we go through our sickness isn't for us? Our sickness is to show someone else, to make somebody else a believer. That, oh, my God, you bless this person, you heal this person. Lord, I know that you can be a healer. I know that you can be a blessing. You know, there's so many things that are happening in the church right now, and so many people can't say that they've seen miracles because there are no slaves in the church. Don't nobody want to just throw themselves at the altar. There's nobody coming to prayer. Nobody wants to be in prayer. Nobody wants to seek his face. We would rather tweet on Facebook to look all deep and wonderful, but we don't want to pick up our word and read it. When it comes time to pray, and I know I'm guilty sometimes, you know, you want to just lay there in your bed and pray, you know, and then you end up like those disciples, you end up falling asleep, amen. And you know, that's why sometimes we don't get the things that we need to get, because I believe that God just turns a deaf ear. He may not sleep on us, but he gonna play the da-da-da-da to us. He gonna be like, well, you know, you saying all this stuff, but you don't wanna hear nothing I'm saying. So many times in the church, we have this mentality, what can the church do for me? What can God do for me? But have we ever stopped to think to ourselves, what can I do for God? What can I do for my neighbor? I have all this extra money. This money just mysteriously happened, you know, ended up in my bank account. And I see the mothers of the church, you know, trying to get their little monies together. Why don't we be a blessing? A lot of times we aren't blessed because we aren't being blessed. We have $5, so we want to keep those little $5. But I grew up in a time where it was me and my sister. If I had $5, she had $2.50, I had $2.50. Because we don't think about other people anymore. We want to think about ourselves. I'm not going to be before you long, but even we need to get back to a slave mentalities in the area of praise. Because David said in Psalms 100, enter into his gates with thanksgiving, enter into his courts of praise. He's not asking you, he's telling you. We're entering into his house because we should want to be here. We should think about the car wreck that we saw happen before us, that we were sitting there murmuring and complaining. That car wreck could have been us. So So we should walk into his house giving him praise and thanks because it wasn't us. We see so many times people getting shot on TV, and we know that some of our siblings or even ourselves were in the wrong place at the wrong time. But God allowed us to walk right past that bullet. God allowed us to walk right past that situation. But we come to God's house acting like God owes us. God don't owe us anything. And you know, in the church, we've developed such a mentality of entitlement. We feel that, you know, I'm just gonna show up and the Lord's just gonna bless me. No, you have to put some action to that. You have to put some action to that. There should be no time that we enter into God's house and there should be a pull. We should just come in and just flow because we're thinking about what the Lord did for us, or we're thinking about where the Lord kept us from. A lot of times, you know, we look at people that die from things that we deal with in our body. But it's not because God was just so, you know, so selfish to them. Amen. It's because we developed that slave mentality that, Lord, your that slavery is gonna make me praise you. I'm gonna slave out to your word. I'm gonna slave out to your blessings. Amen.